What is that? What's playing? I'm trying to guess what it is.
Wild Thoughts.
Okay, I see ya. Everybody in this, can everybody hear me? Just want to make sure. Oh, is that like a jazz mix?
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Too much? I play it during my events, so everyone's like, is this jazz? And it goes from that to everyone singing karaoke style, so.
That's awesome.
I've cracked the code.
Hello. All right, everybody, we're gonna kick this off. I've got my podcasting mic thing because I'm trying to be fancy these days. And just as a quick heads up, what's gonna happen is I am doing daddy daycare this evening. So my 21 month old is literally on the floor watching Cocomelon. So if you hear him interject or feel like he has an opinion, my sincerest apologies. But anyway, just to kick things off again, thank you so very much, everybody, for joining us. Like, we're so excited to have you, you know, be a part of this amazing event where we get to, you know, explore photography and just touch base on, you know, something where a lot of people, like, you know, everybody's like, why is MoPOP doing this photography workshop and what is this all about? So just to give you a little bit of context, first of all, my name is Kwapi and I am the public engagement producer here at the Museum of Pop Culture. And I would love to welcome you to this special Contact High exhibit, exhibition, a visual history of hip hop photography workshop. And so just to give you a little context, I'm not sure how many of you have gotten a chance to check out our Contact High exhibit, but it's an incredible exhibit which allows guests to see how artists like the Notorious B.I.G., Aaliyah, the Wu-Tang Clan, so Mix-a-Lot, and so many more define themselves to the public. You know, we explore hip hop throughout the United States, including the regional cultures that flourished in different parts of the U.S. In addition to photography, we're going to have artifacts out on display, Tupac Shakur manuscript, flavor magazines, costume from Sha Rock, Notorious B.I.G., and all these amazing things. Again, it's an amazing immersive exhibit, which I think you all enjoy. But before I introduce our amazing guest and facilitator for today, I just wanted to walk through a little bit of housekeeping so that we all have a wonderful and engaging experience. Because with these Zoom things, it's tried to be, you know, as many of you know, Zoom bombing and all that stuff has been a thing in the past. So besides our hosts and panelists, we have all mics muted, or if you could please keep your mic muted. However, you're all more than welcome to drop some questions, some thoughts, comments, and questions in the chat. Just make sure you select the all panels and attendees option so that we can all engage with each other. There will be a Q&A segment, so feel free to save more of your questions for later as well, but you can also drop them in the chat and I can convey them to Kariba as she goes. And please remember that this is a safe space for everyone. Let's be kind, courteous, and respectful to each other. Anyway, without further ado, allow me to introduce to you your photography workshop facilitator, the talented Kariba Jack. Now, I'm gonna just give you this spiel of Kariba. First of all, I've known Kariba since college, you know, so this is the homie. But you know, Kariba is this amazing photographer who loves capturing the now, based in the Pacific Northwest, Washington State Cougar alum, Seattle to be exact. She specializes in natural photography with bold and vibrant approach to her portrait and wedding clients. You know, she's photographed many events and worked with celebrities such as Trey Songz, Maya, who was my childhood crush, Keisha Cole, Wale, Common, Carrie Hilson, Neon, Tank, just to name a few. And photography is not just her profession, but her passion as well. So Kariba, thank you so much for taking the time to share your talents and just, you know, engage with us.
Thanks for having me, first and foremost. So we're going to do this together since there's only two squares outside of you. This is going to be really intimate, and I'm so excited about that. So yeah, and you guys can see my slides, correct?
I can see them on my end. So everybody just make sure, can you check out, do you see her slides, which are amazing, by the way? Definitely better than my PowerPoints. So.
So yeah, my name is Kariba Jack. I'm based here in Seattle, Washington. I'm actually currently in my studio in West Seattle. So I got this studio to do photography, but I'm a photographer slash creative entrepreneur. So it's a little mixture of stuff that I actually do in this space. And so I made the lights kind of match my original slides outfit. Do you see that? Okay, just keep up with me, guys. A little bit about me. I'm Nigerian American. Yeah, the youngest of four kids. And if you know anything about having African parents, you know that being a photographer was a shock to my parents because I wasn't the doctor, engineer, lawyer, even dentist that I should have been, but is now greatly accepted. So that's great. I've been doing photography for 11 years. So right after I graduated from WSU, I got a corporate job at the Grand Hyatt. I was a group reservations coordinator. And from there, I literally happily quit and then took my tax return money and bought my first camera. And that was 11 years ago. yeah, I do portraits and weddings and events. And I mean, the sad part about the whole event thing with the pandemic is I would stack a giant chunk of my money during the holiday season / the summer. So summertime would be weddings, holiday seasons would be corporate events. So that's kind of been a, you know, jab in my side. But beyond that, we're getting through this. Like I said, based in Washington State, Seattle. And I was the former CEO of Black Female Photographers. I realize you can't see the R and the S with this. And I just noticed that. So my bad. And I have been internationally and nationally published, which is kind of strange. Me looking at it now, I'm just like, wow. So a little bit about my journey. I started taking pictures with disposable cameras, you know, the type that you would get and go, and then just take it, turn the flash on and a whole bunch more.
Are those still being made? Like, just out of curiosity.
I think a few of them are. Like, you'll see like custom ones made for like weddings now, but I don't really like see them. Like, they'll put them on like guest tables, they'll be like, join our wedding party, help us capture moments. But now everyone has mobile phones, so what's the big point?
Not to interject, but I was just watching like I think this, it was a Watch Mojo top 10 and like top 20 you know, brands that made mistakes, and they say Kodak had actually invented the digital camera in the 70s, and then they were like, oh, let's just stick with film. Yeah, and then yeah, so anyway, it's my bad. It just reminded me about this random thing I was watching yesterday.
It's all good. So that was elementary school. In high school, I transitioned to those point and shoot cameras. I had a Sony at one time. I think I had two Sonys. And I used to always take my mom's camera and take pictures of Reggie Miller on the TV screen because I was obsessed with him, and he played for the Indiana Pacers. I know it doesn't make any sense, but something about his eyes, I'm like, look at him. And so my mom would develop her film, and there'll be just tons of pictures of the TV screen, random. And then after college, like I said, I quit at the Hyatt, and I said, I'm going to do this entrepreneur thing, full-fledged, 2 feet in, and I got my first DSLR, and that stands for Digital Single Lens Reflex. And we'll get more to that in a bit. I do have a question. There you go, coffee house on. A question for you guys that are here. Are any of you photographers? Do you take pictures now? Do you have a camera? If so, can you drop those details in the chat? Because I would like love to know. So let's get into it. Actually, that question is really good. Hopefully you can answer that like sooner rather than later, if you guys have cameras and or take pictures. Moving on. So what is photography? Well, photography is the art, application, and practice of creating durable images by recording light. You guys can read the rest of that slide there. The really cool thing about it is they always say like photographers are light chasers. And I always say, if you have really good light, you can take amazing photos. But without light, it's very, very difficult to take images because it is capturing light. I saw something on Twitter, I think it was yesterday, and it really stuck out to me and I loved it. I'm like, wow. I mean, I have the wow moment, but they tweeted it. But they said that photographers paint with light and time. So, I mean, we're out here painting as well. I mean, I don't have a brush, but I have a camera. I do digital, so I have digital cameras. But I just thought that was, like, really, really neat perspective when I saw that tweet. Moving on. So why is photography important? It's important because this is how we document life and history. And I remember when I started back, like I mentioned, I'm the only one in the arts in my family. And so I'm a really big advocate for STEAM. And I used to tell my parents, like, man, like back in the days, people used to like draw on cave walls. And like, that's how you would tell stories of what's happening. And it was through those sketched images and all of that. So we are kind of our own cave people for our time through photography and how we are capturing moments to live through time. And another thing that I find very, very important, and this is what I tell all of my clients, is that we have to create our version of history, because we can wait for other people to create it for us by taking pictures and documenting things. But if we're not telling our story through our lens, that's really tricky. Thanks. Okay. So yes, Okay. So photography basics. Since you have been taking photos, I know, Kwapi, you've taken photos. I'm not sure about Rashad, if you've taken photos or not, but there's those three key elements to photography, and that's aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. The best way to break those down is aperture is the size of the window. So the bigger the window, the more light comes in. The smaller the window, and these correlate with the f-stops, as you can read in that slide. The smaller the window, the less amount of light. So when I shoot a lot of my type of work, I shoot very, very wide open. So I'm normally around like 1.4, 1.6, 1.8, and different lenses have different abilities to get light in. Shutter speed goes hand in hand with the aperture. So it's about how big the window is or how small the window is, and how quick the shutters, you know, the shutters on a window, old school windows. I don't think a lot of windows nowadays have this, how quick it opens. And it's that moment when the shutters hit that the light goes through and pretty much makes that digital copy of the image. And then it reflects back on digital cameras. I mean, there's mirrorless, but that's another story. And the ISO is the camera sensor's sensitivity to light. Prime example, if you have even your cell phone and you're out taking pictures at night and there's not that much great light available, and I'm meaning like any artificial light, any light in general, street lamps, whatever, and you take a picture and you kind of zoom in, that picture is extremely grainy and a bit blurry just because the camera's trying so hard to pick up any available light to help create an image. So those are the three like basics that are very, very important. They all work together. Different types of photographers use it differently. Yeah, that's, you have a great main camera if that is your main camera right now, and we'll get to mobile phone cameras soon. So those three things. I remember it was a question that my parents asked, what kind of job can you get with photography? And I was like, ha, I laugh in the face of danger. But truly, you could do tons of different things with photography, wedding, portrait events, fashion, school photos, architecture, pet. I mean, the list's there, and it's very interesting, especially with everything that's happened with the pandemic, how many people started at home businesses and quickly realized that you need imagery to put online so people can see your product. And that imagery has to kind of compete with these companies that have photographers in-house or they're outsourcing to photographers to capture products. But you'd be surprised what mobile phones can do now. And it truly all boils down to, once again, good quality light. And that doesn't necessarily mean natural light that comes from the sun, or diffuse light on a cloudy day. It just means any type of light that you know how to manipulate. So you're kind of like a light bender. So kind of like the Avatar, but not really, but kind of. Okay, so I'm just gonna dive into a couple of the photography styles. Concept photography. I know that this is the type of photography that allowed me to work with a lot of artists. Would I do this in my old age now? Absolutely not. My knees can't handle it. I don't know if you can see the guy at the bottom right of the screen. That's a crouching position and I can't. I'm just not cut out for it. And it's a lot of movement. And I know that there is a lot of risks to it. We're gonna jump back 1 second. What is science photography? Great question. So these are the photographers who actually go in different labs and things of that nature. And they're taking pictures, even of petri dishes, of scientists working on new vaccines. Like, they're in labs photographing what's happening. So this can be them photographing researchers, them photographing different medical equipment, but it's very, very strange. I didn't really know that it was a thing, and it really is. And so I found that to be quite interesting. The other one that I found that was interesting was forensic photography, because at one point in time in my life, I'm like, I want to take pictures of crime scenes, but I just didn't know how I'd be able to sleep at night knowing that that's what I do. But it's a whole like process to even get into that. And yeah, it's not just you have a camera and you're pitching out to like police departments. Hey, sorry, I was distracted a little skin. Sounds okay, Sky. So yeah, so there is concert photography. That top image that you see there, it's a great representation that you can get a job with artists, like directly with those artists, and travel along to all their tour stops and take their picture, because clearly this person's on stage taking a picture of the artist and the crowd. So Raven B, I don't know if you guys know who she is, but she is a photographer that went on tour with Beyonce and Jay-Z. She's phenomenal. A lot of the images of Adele's new work, you know, the singer Adele, she took a lot of those for the artwork for her upcoming album. So it started with her just doing simple concerts and then plugging into social media and being found that way. Wedding photography. These are some images that I took. Wedding photography is lucrative, I'm not gonna lie. The wedding industry in general, I feel like, is pretty inflated. I know that I work with all of my clients with their budgets, but things to like keep in mind when you're doing wedding photography, it's a bit of everything. So it feels like you're doing some landscape photography. It feels like you're doing product shots when you're doing the rings and shoes and close detail shots. And then there's a feeling of almost like being a sports photographer, because you can't really pause a wedding as it's going on, like during the vows and the first kiss. And so you're kind of rapid shooting to get those shots so you don't miss it. Then there's architecture photography. I did not take these. These are from the internet. Thank you, Google. But it's just to give you kind of a sense. So you'll see a lot of this type of work for magazines, high-end design firms. They're looking for photographers who can capture those angles and shapes to really like present their quality of work to a public body. So yeah, this is also boudoir. I did take these photos. Once again, there's some details, there's some close-ups, there's some wide angles. Unfortunately, with how I built this slide, you can't see the full image of all of them, but you kind of get a feel of the overall vibe. Okay, depth of field. What is depth of field? So depth of field is the distance between the closest and the furthest object in a photo that appears like acceptably sharp. So let's jump back real quick. So depth of field for this image, the top right one, I focused in on her eyelashes and her makeup. So her eyes in that image technically are in focus, and that from the depth, it starts to blur out when it further gets out like towards her legs. I think I have more imagery for this one. I took these images as well. The big image of the couple to the far right with the mustard top. The depth of field here, you can really truly see it. The subject in the foreground is in focus, him and his wife. and then the background kind of has that blurred effect. I did not edit that blur. It's the beauty of shooting at different aperture sizes. So I believe this one was shot between either like a 1.6 to a 2.2. So that means that was pretty wide open. And it blurs the background out quite a bit. The bottom left image, those were engagement photos in the blue up in Snoqualmie. And once again, you can definitely tell the depth of field here because they're in the subject and you know that they're not taller than trees, right? So you can see the sense of the tunnel type feel as it goes through. And the top left image, once again, I have the clients in focus and the background has that blur. And once again, that image is bigger, but it cropped it pretty bad on here. Bokeh or bokeh. I don't really know how people pronounce this. English was not my parents' first language. And so I say a lot of things funny. So apologies for that. But in photography, bokeh is the aesthetic quality of the blur produced in out of focus parts. And I know that there was a phase where this was very, very huge. Let me show you an image of what it looks like. Do you guys remember when backgrounds for even laptops and computers had those just giant bubbles, like floating screensavers had that look because it was such a thing. But it's still pretty popular, I'm not gonna lie, but I personally don't see too many photographers going crazy over the lights. You'll see them for a lot of street photographers when they're doing like city type views, but that is a term to remember if anyone is taking notes. I mean, I can send you these slides later, but this is a really cool photography style. Okay, dokie. Product photography. So somebody said that they are taking pictures with their phone as their main camera. And let me kind of go into depth because I took these product photos for a lady who has a jewelry line. And there was key aspects that I feel like I missed when I did this, because this was about 9 to 10 years ago when I first started out. Use a tripod, because if you've taken photos, even with a mobile phone or a big camera, you realize that shake causes a blur, and that blur makes things very, very difficult to focus. And proper lighting. I didn't really know what this client's aesthetic feel was, but she sent me so many pieces that had gold in it. So I used the IKEA coffee table that was at home, which is in black. Then I put her jewelry down, and then I used a soft, warm light bulb. So that's the light that you're seeing. And then the rest of the light comes from the window. So this was all done at home when I was still a terrible photographer. So I know I was not good at this point. But I made it look high end just by using window light and nice to see you. Sorry, you have to go. Window light and just a warm light bulb. And the cool thing with our mobile phones at this point is that they can take quality images. And I say this for iPhone users, no offense to Android. Shameless plug. But for product photography, it's making sure that you have the right setup, that things aren't cluttered, that things are clean. You can purchase backdrops. You can create your own. Like I said, I didn't have a really cool black backdrop, but I'm like, I'm going to make this table work. Use normal lenses. People always think that they need to go over and above and beyond. I just made that into one word. It's weird. With lenses to get these shots, and you really don't, because like I said, mobile phones now can take the pictures that I took in this image, if not even better, and always represent the true colors. So like if you're selling something on an e-commerce website, or like Kwapi said, taking pictures of books, make sure it's the true tone of those colors, because it's the worst thing that if you're posting pictures of a product and someone gets it and the first thing they say, it didn't look like that in the picture. It automatically makes people just have a little less faith in your overall brand, products, and everything that you're bringing to the table. And this is why product photographers make quite a bit of money, because the good ones get booked out and they're doing tons of campaigns for people. And the last part is just doing clean little touch-ups in post-production. So that can be Photoshop. People use different programs on their phones. I mean, Instagram has a lot of functions that you can use to edit your photos. What's the other one? There's many of them. What is that one called? The VSO something. It gives you those cool type of... Hold on, let me just do some research real quick. I have the app, so I don't know why I can't remember off the top of my head.
Why you at it though? What is, like, you know, when you think of like your iPhone and your Android, your Galaxy or your Google Pixel, is it just like the cameras are the same? Is it the software that makes iPhone superior, or it's just like, because I mean, from my understanding, it's the same cameras, really. It's the same people build it. So is it like the software that makes the Apple camera, or is it that like some apps are just optimized to serve Apple more? And I'm just curious about that.
I don't know if it's a software aspect or if it's a hardware aspect, because once again, it's all about the lenses in the cameras, right? And how it's reflecting on the computer chip that's built inside of the phone. So we can do an example for computers, a MacBook Pro or a Gateway or a MacBook Pro and an HP. There's different graphic cards that are in a MacBook that processes tones and colors and images much different than the cooler tones of an HP. And believe me, when I started out, couldn't afford a MacBook Pro, so I had an HP, but I had an iPad. So I would edit clients' photos, throw it to my iPad to make sure that the coloring was right and the tones, and we're like, okay, this is good to go, and then go from there. So I think it has a lot to do with the hardware of the actual cell phone devices and the patents. That's why you're like, oh, this phone's trashed, but the camera's better, but you're kind of boxed in with how much you can do, because the moment you figure that out, then it's like, I put a patent on it, you can't copy it. Hope that kind of answers that question.
No, it definitely does, because it's something I always come across where, you know, you buy this high-end Galaxy or this Pixel, and then at least from the app store, at least the way it was explained from an app perspective, why certain apps perform better for iPhone is that it's harder to create an app that work perfectly for every Android because there's so many different variants of them, whereas Apple is just Apple.
Yeah.
So when you're making your software, it's just optimized for Apple. And then Android, because there's so many on the market, is just like, I'm just going to make the most generic version of this app or this product that can work across all platforms. And then, but anyway, with that said, I'll never go to Apple, but sorry, my bad.
But don't you have a MacBook Pro?
Yeah, but we're talking about phones right now.
I'm just saying, I know that I switched to a MacBook Pro just because of the editing with my photography and knowing that the devices talk to each other better.
But the way my bank account is set up, like, I can't afford one even if I wanted.
I hear you. Portrait and landscape. This is pretty self-explanatory. Here's visuals of it. Different styles capture different feels. And I know that I mainly do portraits and weddings. Photography, not saying portrait or landscape, but with what I do, if I want to get more of a scene, I'm going to back up to get as much as possible, and I'm going to shoot that landscape style. And landscape, once again, is horizontal, left to right. Portrait is vertical, up and down. This was a shoot that I did last weekend, actually. And yeah, portrait and landscape, it works for cameras. And it works for mobile devices as well. And this gives you another feel of what I was just talking about. You get a bigger scope of the image and the scenery, I feel like, especially with nature photographers. You don't see too many nature photographers shooting a lot of things in portrait, but you see plenty of them shooting in landscape mode, just so you can get the big feel of what happening. Okay, mobile photography tips. Number one, clean your lens. I know that sounds crazy, but we always have our phones in our hands, right? Back in the day, like it wasn't as grabbable because, you know, you would either have the Razer flip phone or the Sidekick or whatever, the Nokia brick. That's where I started. But something about our phones, like we're always on it, checking apps, checking bank accounts, and our hands seem to touch these lenses. And then we go to take a picture and we quickly realize like, oh, this is great. We think it's great, but it's truly not because we miss the key component, like getting the oils and the grease and all that off of the lens. That can take your picture from C quality to A, very, very simple. And for the person that has that brand new iPhone 13 Pro Max and the way that it switches with the depth of field, like, oh my gosh, like just please make sure that you always just clean that lens, all the lenses, because there's plenty on the back of your camera. Another photography tip when you're using your phone is to set the focus point. So you'll see a lot of people, let's say we're in Vegas. We all went to Vegas and we do the infamous Bellagio fountains. We go there, we hand someone our phone. Can you take our picture, right? You hand them the phone, they take the phone. What do? They point it at you, they hit the button and they go, here you go. And in your head, you know that either you're out of focus, the background's overexposed, so it's too bright, or it's underexposed, which is super dark. You're thinking to yourself, well, I have melanin. I'm mad at myself for not pre-turning on the flash. There's so many things that go through my head, but there's these little tips that you can like do to save yourself from that heartache and, you know, clenching your pearls because it was a perfect opportunity missed. So the cool thing with iPhones is you can set your focal point. And this is like, if you're doing things that are close up and small detail shot, you can set that. And then you can go up and down with your finger and toggle that exposure. And once again, the cool thing with these newer iPhones, and it might be the same for Android newer phones, is the capability to kind of shoot in RAW. And that's pretty much shooting digital images. It's not really a finalized image. It needs another computer program to process it. So when that goes in there, it's just different wavelengths of light that eventually then gets condensed down to create an image. So yeah, set the focus point and adjust the exposure. And the other thing that's kind of cool to get those professional looking photos with a mobile device is portrait mode. It's very strange because I don't necessarily use portrait mode as much as one would think. But I do use it for front facing camera when it's at facing me. Byrishad, thanks for tuning in. But with the portrait mode, I think this is times two, and I think there's a times one, which pulls her face back just a little bit, so you get more of the background image as well. And it gives you that digital photography type look and feel and vibe. But personally, just play with it and toggle with it to learn how to use that better. And Kwapi, I'm not sure, I'm just gonna chime in with you. Do Android phones have that portrait mode as well?
Yes, they do.
Okay.
Yeah, there is a portrait. How backward do you think, Andre? I have to ask how bad, you see? You see, like portrait mode right there.
Got it. So we all have, I wasn't sure. I haven't had an Android in.
Wow. Like
8 years. I don't know.
Wow.
Anyway. So those are some mobile photography tips. And if you have any questions about mobile photography, feel free to drop them. I always have been told that I'm the worst at taking cell phone pics, but I'm actually getting better with my phone now. And editing post-production. So you can be a very mediocre to beginner photographer and have the best editing and post-production skills, and it will take you from this level to like off the charts. And I say that because I have seen some photographers, I'm like, you took that? And they're like, yeah, I took it and I edited it. But you look at the raw images, what's actually in camera, and will blow your mind. So there's Adobe Lightroom, Adobe Photoshop, there's Capture One, which is a different product. It's not through Adobe. I'm gonna show you some representations of that. So this is kind of what you would see if you were to log into Photoshop. I only primarily use Photoshop for doing intense detail, cleaning and work and lines and polishing a photo. It's such a powerful application that it does take up like a lot of room, but the things that you can do with it, like in this image, this woman is completely almost they desaturated her in this edit, but I did not take this picture, side note. They desaturated her, brought the vibrance out in her outfit, probably like added that color, then the background and the jewelry is not even real jewelry, like it's digital manipulation to create that. So it's a very, very powerful tool. And like I'm saying, like you can put mediocre photos or fabulous photos into this program and edit it to a level that will blow your mind. This is Adobe Lightroom. These are clients that I photographed about a month ago. And what you can see with Adobe Lightroom is that you can batch photos. So I batch giant chunks of photos at a time. I can go over to this area, see if you can see my cursor, change the color temperature here. And that's like if it's a warmer or cooler. So the first image, this one, it's much cooler. You'll see more blue tones. And I upped it just a bit to get it more warm for this. And it's just, it allows you to sync. So that's down here. You see previous right now, but it allows you to sync an editing style. So if I did one image, I'm like, oh, I love the tone. I love the color. I'm going to highlight the next six images after that and push that sync button, and it will just mimic those edits on all of them. It will leave out the spot correction and things like that. But Adobe Lightroom and Adobe Photoshop are best friends, and they do like talk to each other and they bounce back and forth in the editing portion. Poppy, yes?
I don't know why I'm raising my hand. So like, I've always wondered, like from your photography perspective, like how do you pick, like, is it just more like an eyeball test, like a feeling like, you know, this is the color, this is a, you know, this is the light, the saturation, this is what I'm going for? Or is it like more, there's a standard out there that photographers know, like this is the standard of what the treatment you want for a photo?
No, it's totally per photographer. So you'll see some photographers that have a very, very warm overall tone to all of their images. And some of them might have a warm and grainy feel. Those are all things that are their personal style and preference, because we can all take one same image and edit it in hundreds and hundreds of different ways. For me, I really like vibrance, and I really like that like color pop and punch type feel. So that's why I have my style. I have the same process every session that I shoot. I upload it into Lightroom. I look at the before and afters, and I start with the very first images, and I go through quickly to see if eyes are closed, if something's just not quite right. I'll delete those out. And that's called culling. So it's the culling phase. And from there, I go back to my natural color range that I like. And I up the brightness if it was shot too dark, because it's difficult being a photographer in Washington State, because we don't get sun as much as photographers in Florida or Atlanta or even New York. New York gets a different type of phase when it's snowy. All that light reflects off of snow. So it's like we have rain and overcast. And so creating bright, vibrant photos year round for me, it's been a challenge, but it's something that I finally learned to master. So to answer your question, it's totally up to a photographer's preference when they get into these programs. And then of course there's presets that you can start creating for yourself. So you're like, this is my editing style. I'm going to keep it in these ranges, save that. So the next time you import photos, you can quickly hit that and punch it. This is another edit. This is from Lightroom itself. So you can kind of see what you can do. Sorry, this is Photoshop. No, this is Lightroom. This is in the develop stage. So this is a side-by-side. So you can actually throw this up on your screen. And I know it looks like I'm looking to the left because I have an additional monitor that has us all on there. But when I edit, I have my computer and I have my external monitor. They're talking to each other. I have the original in front of me that I'm editing, and then to my left, I can see everything that's happening. So this gives you a good like before and after type feel of what I just try to explain. And it's really good to see where you started from and where you're going when it comes to editing photos. So yeah, this is Capture One. I have a handful of photographer friends who use this. So like I said, this is the program that they pull their photos in from, and they start working and manipulating their post-production there. I don't personally have this program. I've stuck with Adobe, but this is another one that's really, really great that photographers use. And so that just gets you back to us talking about this, the three popular, there's plenty more out there, post-production editing softwares. Questions?
I don't know. I don't want to take up space. And everybody, like, feel free to ask questions. So for me, like, you know, one of the things I struggle with is, so I have DSLRs, right? Which I used to use for video and so forth. But like, my phone, whether I don't know if I'm lazy or I'm intimidated, it could be both, you know? But I struggle, like, for me, the thing I struggle with most is staging, you know? Okay. Finding, let's say there's, okay, so this book, right? Hair Love, right? So I'm trying to figure out, like, in terms of, like, how to stage it. Fine, I could take it on a white background, but if I want the colors to pop, is it just more figuring out what contrasts best with it? Because I've seen people take a photo on with the book on grass and it looks amazing, and I do the exact same thing, and it doesn't look good. And I like staging and so forth, like, how, because you're talking about product photography, I think, which is kind of in line with books and everything, like, how do you decide, okay, this is going to be staged or this is just going to be a plain background and let the camera do what it does?
Great question. I think it also goes back to that post-production aspect, because with product photography, you're trying to convey the product. So you don't want to be too distracting, and you want everything that's around it to be complementary. Of course, you can shoot things on a white backdrop or a solid color, but to me, that feels pretty sterile. So with that book, for example, I would take one of the colors that has a complementary color and use that in a fabric tone, right? It doesn't need to be smooth. It can be kind of like rippled. You can half put it in a sitting chair, so the back has a ripple and then the bottom portion of the chair has the rest of it, and place the book on the bottom portion of that chair, and now start, let the chair be one of these spinning chairs just so you can utilize window light and any artificial light for a fill, and just see how that plays. Now you can get creative with it. You can get, it says Hair Love, right? You can put a couple hair products with it that might have been mentioned in the book or not mentioned. There you go, right? You can place them next to each other, cross promote as you're taking this product shot. So that, yes, a plant, because it grows like roots from hair. All of these different things, I think it all boils down to light and how the light's hitting on these objects, because you don't want too many shadows unless it's intentional shadows. You'll see people put palm leaves or any type of plant to cast shadows on objects when it's shot. So like, for instance, this, if I wanted this eye to be darker, the light's covering it from here and it gives you more of a mysterious type vibe, right? So I think it's about playing with it. There's no right and wrong way. It's all about like the aesthetic of how you shoot it, because nobody woke up one day saying, oh, all product photography needs to look like this. They were just like, oh, well, if you shoot it on white, it's pretty easy. We can manipulate the images. We can pull it. We can edit it later. We can put it on the website. But if it's an overall brand for, you see, some skincare, they drop it in water, right? To give you that sense of refreshing and revitalizing, because water is, you know, the key to life, right? So it just depends on how you want to portray that book. And if you want to keep it simple, you can place it on a beautiful wooden coffee table warm up the tones with the light that's around it, capture the book, because hair love, and when you think like warmth and cozy, it's like, it's a warmer type tone when I think of it. Other people might think differently. So that's a suggestion.
I'm gonna take a photo, I'm gonna send it to you, and you're gonna critique it. And then you'll let me know if I did a good job or not.
And then you can do it in portrait mode and whatnot with your mobile phone as well and see how that goes.
See, okay, in fact, that's another thing. Does where you plan to host or share the image affect, like, you know, cause I mean, Instagram, for example, you could go portrait, you could go landscape, or you could go the one by one ratio too. And does that, you know, when we start talking about depth of field and all those things, how does that factor into where you're gonna, and is it gonna be something that's digitally displayed versus I'm gonna print it and frame it at home?
That's a great question. Number one, I cannot stand when clients take a beautiful landscape picture, one of these, and crop it into a square and then center themselves in it. Because I'm like, you are framed in the rule of thirds, right? Like images, there's a grid in photography, right? Rule of thirds, 1, 2, and 3. And then there's another 1, 2, and 3, it makes 9. So I can't imagine when people happily crop out all the details that make that image spectacular. But when it comes to product photography in particular, when you're taking those pictures and it's for social media, I always say take multiple options and multiple angles, because you can do a 1-by-1 ratio for Instagram, or you can do that 4-to-3 ratio, right? And now they've allowed you to do the horizontal ones. Granted, it depends on the aesthetic of your feed, if you want to have full blocks or not. But if you're posting on Facebook, save yourself the hassle and do a fuller frame, because it gives you more space. If you're posting on, what's the other apps? Twitter, it's the same. It allows you to do the entire image, so you don't necessarily have to crop. But you can always tell, like when you're on Instagram, you kind of have to shift a picture up or down because it doesn't give you that full, what is it, 16:9? Is that what it is? Because it does 4:3. Yeah, it doesn't give you that whole option to get the whole body in there. And it's always like an eye twitch. So when you're taking pictures, kind of just have that in the back of your mind to give it enough space so you can get as much as you want in that frame. Also, this one's my frat brother, and I have no idea who he is or what he looks like. I'm trying to figure this out. But hey, frat. But yeah, any other questions?
Yeah, I actually have a question, but I want to say thank you for, you know, presenting and being here today. Really appreciate it. I'm getting into concert photography myself, and I have a few examples, but I have a lens that doesn't have the greatest aperture setting. And so, and I have a, for my body camera, I have a Sony A6100. So I was wondering if you have any recommendations for one of those like big body lenses that you see concert photographers carrying around, or if I even need one of those for it.
One more question. What's the type of photography that you're getting into?
Concert photography.
So I would suggest the 24-70mm. To start off with, because that gives you the option to like zoom with it. And then you'll see some concert photographers that have one giant wide angle lens. Mm-hmm. I mean, even do like a 35mm. It just depends on how you're going to be moving, how much access to the stage area that you'll have. If you're the type that you're starting out and you don't have access to get up close so you can be like right underneath the artist, I would say definitely get a lens that allows you to zoom. Okay. So the picture that's up there right now, that's the 24-70. Mm-hmm. It gives you enough space, but it also takes in really good light because it's a 2.8 lens, if that makes sense.
2.8 aperture, right?
Yeah. And to be honest with you, I swear any lens that has lower aperture availability is going to give you a different type of depth of field and just quality when you shoot with it. And most importantly, your glass, which is your lenses, is so much, well, from my perspective and a handful of other photographers, so much more important than the body of your camera, because you'll see photographers that have the latest, greatest bodied cameras. And you're like, what are you shooting right now? What is this? And so you can have a decent camera body and like really great glass. And a really good way to start that is to go to Glazier's Cameras. It's in downtown Seattle and they do rentals. And you can rent any lens that you want to kind of practice with and get a feel for before you buy. And I know that that's what I did. And I think rentals are what, like $30 to $60, maybe $100 for the weekend. And that's from Friday, turning it back in either Sunday or Monday. But definitely do that. It's called Glazier's Camera. They have like the main store where you can buy lenses and all the equipment that you need. And then they have a rental store.
Okay.
Are you in Seattle? Sorry, I didn't even ask.
I'm in Tacoma.
Perfect. Yeah. So try Glazier's. Tacoma, what do they have? There's another one that you could like mail and pick up your lenses, but your best bet is like go in with your camera body.
Okay.
And then like test it out, because that's what I always did. I'm like, can I see this one? They're like, sure. I'm like, oh, this one might, let me try this. Because there's so many prime lenses. Those are, you know, lenses that you can't focus and change things. Let me not say focus. You can focus on every lens. You can't zoom. So there's zoom lenses and then the prime. So when I was doing concerts and events, I primarily had my 35 millimeter on always. And when I wanted to get close up of like artist faces and things like that, I'll put on my 85 millimeter. So I was only shooting with primes up until 2 years ago when I got the 24 to 70. But if I had that prior, whoo, game changer.
Okay. No, that's solid. I appreciate that. And then you said frat brother, so I'm assuming you're a Zeta.
I am.
Okay. Okay. Blue and white connection. Okay. I like it.
I don't even know what you look like. I'm like, who is this? Like I saw when you like logged in, I was like, okay. Right.
No, it's real. It's real. Trust me. Trust
me. That's so fun. Like, and you're both Wazoo alum.
Exactly.
Wait, what year did you graduate?
2019.
Oh my gosh. Okay, I understand. I graduated in 2008. Wow.
Okay. Okay. I see you. I see you.
And you don't go back to your alma mater and teach. Shame on you, Kariba.
The thing is, that drive, I did it so many times, and I drove everybody's cars, and so I probably drove to Pullman and back more times than the people who owned their cars.
Wow. I have a question, actually. You know, it's kind of tied to, you know, when you all were talking about lenses and cameras, and then I won't even go into the DSLR versus mirrorless, because that's above my, you know, you know, but like, would you say cameras? So I have a D51, Nikon D51, and a D3200. But do you feel like cameras have like a quote unquote expiration date, or it's really about once you get comfortable with your tool, you can do anything with it, regardless of how old or new it is? Or there is some value in always trying to get the latest and best? Or maybe that's just with phones? Or do you think phones have kind of programmed us to just always want the latest thing?
So no and yes. So the no part is there's certain aspects of, or maybe this is the yes. I just confused myself. I remember I started off with the Nikon D3500, right? And I thought the biggest jump in the world was the 5000. No, was it the 5000 I started with? The thing with those beginner DSLR cameras is the sensors in their bodies. So if I'm doing any outdoor photos and there is nothing but beautiful natural light, I'm golden, because during the daytime it's great. Now they're like, hey, Kariba, can you photograph a wedding? I can say yes, and then I'm quickly shooting myself in the foot saying, oh no, I shouldn't have done that, because the camera body that I have, the sensor inside can't pick up low light situations, right? And so you see these photographers constantly getting new equipment, and then you see the work that they're producing. You're like, wait, what changed? You're like, oh, the sensors and the cameras got better because technology is ever evolving, right? So the better those sensors are, the better quality images you can get. And this isn't like saying, oh, you're bad at exposing a photo or it's shaky or grainy. It's literally the camera body can do so much, and certain cameras are limited because of the hardware that's inside of it. Does that make sense?
Makes complete sense. And thank you for letting me know it's not me. it's not me. Because like it's you know, like, so when I initially got the cameras, like, you know, it was for shades of black. So I was using it for videography, right? Yeah. It was the cheapest way to get a camera that would give me great HD quality. But after that was done, now I have these cameras and I'm like, oh, you know, I could dabble in just fun photography. Just go out and go for a walk and, you know, maybe I'll see Bigfoot, snap a photo, you know? Yeah. But like, it's always just been about enough. And maybe it's some of it is posted and some of it is like, you know, and understanding raw images too versus like, you know, because you can take a raw image and then take that into Lightroom or take that into Photoshop, whatever your software is. But to me, there was just the post part is what always like overwhelmed me too. Like, okay, I've got this raw image. I plugged it in there. I'm tinkering with these, histographs. I don't know what you want. Like, and then, but I don't know if I'm doing anything.
The thing is, you muted it at a perfect point because it started to rattle, that pitch of his cry. There's so much that your camera can do. And when you max that out, that's it, right? There's so much that editing can do when you do have raw images. I only shoot in raw images because it's literally digital noise and it allows me to make up for any capturing mistakes. So I normally have a tendency of slightly underexposing everything that I photograph so I can bring in more light, because if you overexpose an image when you take it, it blows everything out from the start. And it's hard to get those details back, extremely hard sometimes. And then you're like trying to stitch photos together and it's a mess. But post-production took me, I think it was like 3.5 weeks of YouTube University to learn it. And I would be up to like 4 or 5 in the morning, the sun will be coming up. I'm like, all the information's there. Like, how can I tap into it? So I would have the program running. I have my iPad up, learning how to edit. I'm like, oh, this is what this toggle does. Oh, this is what this does. But you're going to come to a point with those cameras that you're going to be like, wait a minute. Yeah, these cameras are great for what, 2007, 2006, 2007, 2008. And now you're looking at your mobile phone that has a better camera quality on it. And so you're just like, I now see it. Because there's engineers working day in and day out trying to get the next best thing, the next camera that captures a speckle of light. Because I know with these iPhones, I took it to San Diego right when I got it and took pictures of palm trees at night, and the ambient light that was there lit these trees up so beautifully that I'm like, my old phone couldn't do this at all. So it's a stacking game. So I hope that answers your question.
And I know we're way past time. I don't know if anybody else has any questions, but like, you know, thank you so much, Kariba. And like, great thing is that we were recording this, so we'll be able to share it with you too. Like, it was awesome. Thank you so much.
Wait, does Chioma have a question? Did I say that name right? So, do you have a question by chance? No, you just pop back up.
No, yes.
I know, right? I feel bad.
And people can always email me questions too, and I'll forward them to you.
Yeah, and you guys follow me on social media so then I can like follow you back and see your type of work and help out.
Nah, I feel like you'll judge me. Feel like you'll judge me.
It's all about community, okay? I won't judge you.
We already follow each other, but I'm not.
In my head, everyone's judging to a certain extent. I think it's like the survival of the fittest, but yeah. Awesome. This was fun.
Thank you so very much. I really appreciate your time, and have an amazing weekend. Go Seahawks. I would say go Cougs, but I'm not that. Yeah.
Right. Same for me. I'm always just like, I'm okay.
All right. I'll talk to y'all later. Have a good evening, everyone. Have a safe weekend. Stay out of the rain. Bye.